resources. As we all know, we go through the mnemonic or acronym of CHAM whenever see a patient with heart failure. C stands for coronary, H for hypertensive, A for arrhythmia, M for mechanical, and P for pulmonary embolism. So you basically work through these and then find out what is the probable cause of heart failure, and then you proceed with definitive strategy. As for any standard heart failure patients, the evaluation would begin with specific cardiac tests, including ECG, echocardiogram, troponin, and NT-proBNP. And of course, we will do routine tests, including complete blood picture, creatinine, TSH, calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, and GlyHb. However, at times, we are not able to identify the specific cause of heart failure. Like, for example, a patient may be a suspected case of restrictive cardiomyopathy, or at times myocarditis, or at times chronic constrictive pericarditis. Sometimes they may be having inflammatory or infiltrative cardiomyopathy. So how do we proceed to evaluate these patients? Because at times it is very important that we come to a specific treatment strategy based on the diagnosis. Let us hear it from Professor Ramchandra. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Tom. So this is a very important topic because diagnosing heart failure, especially systolic heart failure, ever since we have had echocardiogram, has become very easy. So we just have to look at the symptoms and signs of heart failure, because like we all know, it is a symptom syndrome complex, and then use the ECG and the echocardiogram, and we get the diagnosis in most cases. The diagnosis of diastolic dysfunction heart failure or heart failure with preserved ejection fraction has become much easier ever since NT-proBNP or BNP has come to most of our labs. Otherwise, it would have been very difficult. So once BNP is there, and in case the BNP is normal, we have to do an exercise test to see that pulmonary hypertension or dyspnea is developing in this patient, then we have a diagnosis of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. But many times the etiology is what is most important, and we give up on etiology in many of these cases of restrictive cardiomyopathies. I remember many years back, I had a young patient whom I thought was a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. It looks restrictive, huge atria, bilateral atrial enlargement. And then for years, we were treating him, and then it turned out to be amyloidosis, and he passed away. And we felt really bad that we could not diagnose this patient. So it is very important to diagnose, especially in this era, because we have specific treatments nowadays for most diseases. So coming to the definitions of heart failure, as you all know, just a short this thing, it is the inability of the heart or the pumping system to meet the metabolic demands of the body, or it's able to do it only at a higher cardiac filling pressure. So these two are the most important things. Usually the symptoms are effort intolerance, fluid retention, and there is reduced longevity, whether it is systolic or diastolic heart failure. And basically, there's a structural or functional cardiac disorder that impairs the ability of the ventricle to fill or eject blood. So basically, it should be a cardiac problem, and it is associated with these symptoms of fluid retention and effort intolerance. And it's not able to maintain adequate cardiac output that is needed for the body, or it's able to do so only with higher filling pressures. So that is the definition of heart failure. So how do we make the diagnosis? We have these typical signs and symptoms, and the echocardiogram that shows an ejection fraction of less than 40%. Then, of course, you diagnose heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. So a pretty easy diagnosis. The other diagnosis of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction or mid-range ejection fraction needs positive BNPs, and it also needs either one of these, either a structural abnormality of the heart, which means in most cases left ventricular hypertrophy or left atrial enlargement, or some other indicators of diastolic dysfunction, either on echocardiogram or on cardiac catheterization. So it basically needs all these things to diagnose heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. So signs and symptoms, the echocardiogram, which might almost look normal, but you have to look for symptoms, signs of diastolic dysfunction and signs of structural heart disease along with a positive BNP. So the etiology of heart failure, as you know, like Dr. Tom said, you do some common tests like CBC, creatinine, ferritin, TSH, troponin, and the natriuretic peptides. So these are sort of mandatory. And you look at it, they will solve many problems. Troponin will tell you if the person is having a sort of myocarditis or maybe acute MI for that matter, which you are not able to diagnose. The natriuretic peptides are anyway important for diagnosis. Thyroid is something that you might miss if you don't test. Ferritin, very important, because you get an idea if the guy, if the person has iron overload, cardiac dysfunction. Creatinine, you might miss the renal failure, which might again be a cause. And the complete blood picture, which will show you eosinophilia, or it might show you some blood dyscrasia, which might tell you that the person is prone for amyloidosis. So these are the basic tests, which again give us a lot of information. So ferritin is one thing that we always do, because in heart failure anyway, you want to know if the person has low irons also. Nowadays, the criteria are there when if the person has low ferritin and low concentrations of saturations, then you would transfuse them with IV iron. So then you divide these people into patients with reduced ejection fraction, heart failure with normal ejection fraction, and of course the congenital heart disease. And then you, like Dr. Tom said, you have to exclude these most common causes of heart failure. These are valvular heart disease, coronary artery disease, hypertension, and left ventricular hypertrophy because of hypertension, what we would call as hypertensive heart failure, tachycardiomyopathies, and congenital heart disease. So these five things need to be excluded before we go on to a more detailed workup of the etiology of heart failure. So it's very easy to diagnose these things, tachycardiomyopathy. Sometimes if the person has atrial fibrillation and comes back to you in sinus rhythm, it might be a bit difficult, but otherwise in most cases, very easy. Valve disease, very easy by echocardiogram. To rule out ischemic coronary artery disease, that we'll talk in some detail. And hypertensive heart disease, the history of hypertension, left ventricular hypertrophy, and other target organ damages involved in hypertension, that will tell you the diagnosis. And of course, echocardiogram again for the congenital heart disease. So these five things have to be ruled out before we get on to the more detailed etiological diagnosis of heart failure. So the classification of heart failure initially, most of them were supposed to be cardiomyopathies, which meant that they were basically intrinsic diseases of the heart. And then in 2006, for the first time, the American Heart Association gave a classification of cardiomyopathies that had a genetic component also. Previously, the genes were largely ignored because they were most probably not known. So they divided it into primary cardiomyopathies and secondary cardiomyopathies. The secondary were due to these causes, infiltrative diseases, storage diseases, toxicity, endomyocardial fibrosis, inflammatory disorders, endocrine, autoimmune, and neuromuscular like Friedreich's ataxia. And the primary, which means the primary involvement was with the heart, it was again divided into morphological, into hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, dilated or restrictive cardiomyopathies. And then these were the genetic things like the LV non-compaction, glycogen storage, conduction defect, mitochondrial cardiomyopathies. And they also included the electrical problems in the classification of cardiomyopathies, the ion channels, long QT syndrome, Brugada, and other things. So the acquired ones were mainly the acquired ones pertinent to the heart only, which means they were rather limited to the heart. They're mainly these things, myocarditis, which we'll talk about, stress-induced, which we will not talk about, but it's a relatively easy diagnosis. Usually there is a classical history of stress, and then there is ballooning of either the apical or the mid part, or sometimes the basal part, usually the apical part. And if you look at the PET or the CT, this is classically lack of inflammation. And of course, the coronaries are normal. So basically, this is an easy diagnosis. And the best thing is the heart improves usually in a week's time, but almost always in a month's time. So that way also you get the diagnosis. Peripartum, of course, again, relatively easy diagnosis. Tachycardia induced, I've already talked about. So basically during these things, I'll be excluding some causes because we will not be concentrating on these later on. The myocarditis part we'll talk about later. So these are the main thing that happened in the 2006 classification was they realized that there were a lot of inherited cardiomyopathies. Initially, the main focus was on hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and it is definitely the most common inherited cardiomyopathy, the prevalence of 1 in 500. Then come the dilated cardiomyopathies, 1 in 2,500, but actually increasing with every year. The genetic proportion that contributes to the dilated cardiomyopathy is increasing every year. Then the arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathies and the restrictive cardiomyopathies, the hereditary ones are rare. And then the LV non-compaction and the Takotsubo also, because it also seems to have some amount of genetic or inherited part also. So the inheritance could be via the sarcomere, like happens in the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, or in the cytoskeleton, like it happens in dilated cardiomyopathy, or in the junctions of the desmosome, that happens in the arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathies. So the classification of cardiomyopathy initially was purely phenotypic, and then in the America in 2006, the American Heart Association added the large genetic component and added the electrical components also to it, including the long QT, the short QT, Brugada, catecholaminergic polymorphic VT, and the Asian sudden nocturnal death syndrome. And then in the European Society of Cardiology gave a slightly different classification, where again it concentrated more on the phenotypic types of disease, which means the hypertrophic, the phenotypic manifestation, rather than the genetic, but again, it classified them genetic-wise also later. So very similar classifications. So this is the list of the classifications that started from 1956 when the basic differentiation was between myocarditis and myocardiosis, which means cardiomyopathy. And then later on, the most recent one is the World Heart Federation's MOGAS classification of cardiomyopathy, which is very important. Although it looks cumbersome, it makes the total diagnosis very easy. So the MOGAS classification has these components: morphological component, which means it could be dilated, the hypertrophic, restrictive, arrhythmogenic, non-compaction, things like this. And sometimes it can have both, which means hypertrophic can move into a dilated cardiomyopathy, things like that. Then the organ involvement, whether it is the heart only or whether it involves the muscle, the nervous system, things like that. The genetic pattern, whether it is autosomal dominant, recessive, no family history, things like that. And then the etiology, the specific gene mutation or things like the amyloid that is present or something like hypereosinophilic heart disease. So basically, the etiological diagnosis, and then the S is for the stage of the American Heart Association heart failure stage, and the NYHA class also. So all this, so basically you have a total description of the person's problem. For example, this person, as you can see, the ventricle is hypertrophied, huge biatrial enlargement. Looks like a restrictive disease also. So you have this morphological pattern of hypertrophic plus restrictive. Organs involved are only the heart. The genetic, the inheritance pattern is de novo, which means there is a mutation that could be transmitted, but there's no previous history of, there's no family history. And then the gene, the exact etiology is a gene mutation. And then the person is in the stage 4 heart failure and class stage D heart failure and in class 4 heart failure. So you have the total thing in just one line. You get a total description of the person's cardiomyopathy or his basic heart ailment. So this has become very important because of the increasing genetic diagnosis of these cardiomyopathies. So this is a mitochondrial cardiomyopathy. As you can see, the ECG has some sort of short PR. Otherwise, it looks like a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but there is some LV dilatation. So morphology is hypertrophic plus dilated, and there's also this WPW also there. And then the organs, large number of organs are involved, the heart, the skeletal muscle, neuropathy, eye, and the auditory system. And then the genetic pattern is is mitochondrial, and the inheritance is mitochondrial, and the genetic mutation is also there. And you can add S also, which means the stage of heart failure, and the class, MIHA class also you can add here. So this is the MOGAS classification that is being currently followed for most cardiomyopathies. So this is something that we need to know. So coming to dilated cardiomyopathy, so we will today discuss the differential, the etiological diagnosis of dilated cardiomyopathies and restrictive cardiomyopathies. And we will not really touch hypertrophic cardiomyopathy because it will become too big, number one. And number two is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is usually an easy diagnosis to make for most of us. So it's the dilated and the restrictive parts are the more complicated ones. So dilated cardiomyopathy is usually a disease of the young. It's a very important, probably the most important cause of sudden cardiac death in young people. Hypertrophic plus dilated, of course, and the commonest indication for heart transplant is dilated cardiomyopathy. So it is basically a diagnosis of exclusion, and it's a echocardiographic diagnosis where the LV diastolic diameter is more than 117% compared to the age and weight, which means there is LV dilatation, and there is usually some amount of LV dysfunction. So this varies, some would say less than 50%, or some would say less than 40%. But so there is basically LV dilatation, and there is some amount of systolic dysfunction also. And like we mentioned earlier, you need to exclude these five causes: ischemic heart disease, hypertension, valvular heart disease, congenital heart disease, and of course, tachycardiomyopathies. So once these are excluded, then what happens is you find that 1/3 of these are genetic, which means they are familial or they are sporadic mutations. 1/3 are post-inflammatory, which means many of these have an evidence of myocarditis. 1/3 seem to be really idiopathic, which means we still are not able to detect a cause. But gradually, more and more idiopathics are moving into the genetic bracket. And in some cases, in 7% of DCMs, even now, when we classify them as idiopathic, if you do an angiogram, they are found to have critical coronary artery disease, which tells us how important it is to rule out ischemia in a very certain manner. And many times there may be a complex interplay. For example, viral myocarditis in genetically susceptible people leading to autoimmunization and gradual LV dysfunction. So basically, just like any other viral infection, if you have a genetic predisposition only, you might get it. Otherwise, you may not get it. So the most important thing is the difference between a dilated and ischemic cardiomyopathy. This is a pretty easy diagnosis by echocardiogram or by MRI, also cardiac MRI, where you see that in ischemic cardiomyopathy, there is regional wall motion abnormality, there is dyskinesia also sometimes, and scarring, which follows a coronary territory. So that is the most important. It follows a coronary territory, and the RV involvement is rare, unless there is pulmonary hypertension. Rarely, of course, you might get a right ventricular MI. If it is associated with tricuspid regurgitation, the RV enlargement and RV dysfunction might continue. But without tricuspid regurgitation, it's very rare to get a prolonged RV dysfunction in ischemic cardiomyopathy. So in these, like I said, it's very important to rule out in a decisive manner to rule out coronary artery disease. So if the person has angina or symptoms, definitely you will proceed to an angiography. If the person does not have symptoms, then in some countries they would do non-invasive rest and stress imaging, and you would stress them by either adenosine or dipyridamole or dobutamine. So you would stress them that way, or directly proceed with an angiogram. And only when the person is very old and you think, he may not be able to revascularize him at all, that is the only time when you will not necessarily rule out coronary artery disease. Otherwise, you usually rule out. So in our practice, most people will get a coronary angiogram, directly a coronary angiogram, and then a cardiac MRI to look for viability or to look for scarring and other issues. So these are the Canadian recommendations, Canadian Heart Association recommendations. So angiogram is performed in heart failure with symptoms. If there are no symptoms, but they have some risk factors for coronary artery disease, also it is performed. And of course, if the non-invasive tests show that there could be ischemia, then also it is performed. So usually most people will end up with a coronary angiogram. And then, of course, a cardiac MRI or a PET is done to see whether what are the chances of improvement of LV function with revascularization. So you can see all these modalities. All of them have reasonably good sensitivity and specificity to tell us that the myocardium that is perfused by that artery will recover if they have these characteristics. For example, on an echocardiogram, if you get a biphasic response showing that there is both ischemia and viability, then most probably it will recover. Similarly, in a cardiac MRI, there is less than 50% thickness and an endocardial scar. So similarly like that, so usually you get a very clear indication in most cases. More complex is a situation where the person has a 50% or a 40% ulcerated single vessel disease, and then there is scarring in those approximate areas producing remodeling and LV dysfunction, in which case you do not know if he's had a prior myocardial infarction producing the dilated cardiomyopathy like thing, or it is something else. So that is the more complex diagnosis. So many times you get this sort of thing. Once you have done the angiogram, you get normal looking angiogram, and then that is when we start thinking what we should do next. We should do a PET scan, we should do a genetic referral, or you should check their thiamine and selenium levels, so no further diagnostic tests. So this is what we are going to discuss. So one of the most important thing is the viral myocarditis part. Let me move this out. So the viral myocarditis, usually many people have a viral prodrome in the last 1 month, or they already have a previous history of myocarditis and it's a relapse, or they have systemic autoimmune diseases, or they have been exposed to some toxins. But usually the viral part is the one that's most important. So we'll go from one spectrum to the other. The worst case scenario is the fulminant myocarditis, which means less than 2 weeks duration, and the person comes with unexplained cardiogenic shock, and the LV has increased septal thickness, and it has some amount of both systolic and diastolic dysfunction. And sometimes it's very peculiar. The LV actually seems to be contracting well, but there is severe cardiogenic shock. But it is not septic shock, it is actually fulminant myocarditis. The way to diagnose is, of course, this increased septal thickness that is found in these young people and the viral prodrome. And then the next one is up to between 2 weeks and 3 months. You call it acute myocarditis, in which case you might get a decreased ejection fraction. The size might be increased, the shape might be more globular. There might be regional wall motion abnormality, or there might be thrombi without significant other problems also. So this also happens sometimes, that there is a thrombogenic element in these people. So all these things can be there in the acute myocarditis. The next one is these arrhythmias that might, the next one is, of course, a myocarditis that presents like a myocardial infarction, which we nowadays see in the COVID type of things, where you get something that looks like a myocardial infarction. You do angiogram and the coronaries are normal. If you get some amount of pericarditis during the very acute phase of that injury, you know that this is something that is involving the whole heart, including the pericardium. So that gives you a diagnosis. But sometimes myocarditis can present like this. The fourth type of presentation is, of course, these the arrhythmias, which means the person doesn't seem to have any other problem. He could be having these ventricular arrhythmias on ECG or Holter or palpitations or complete heart block or high degree AV block or new onset bundle branch blocks. And sometimes they might present with resuscitated sudden cardiac death. So this is a type of presentation for myocarditis. And the fifth most benign presentation is, of course, the unexplained sinus tachycardia, fatigue and exercise intolerance, something like the chronic fatigue syndrome, and you do a cardiac magnetic resonance on them. You can use this Lake-Lewis criteria, which has a 90% sensitivity and specificity to look at both edema by T2, permeability by T1, and scarring by the late gadolinium enhancement. So looking at all these three, you can, in 90% of cases, correctly identify if this person having these vague symptoms has some sort of myocarditis. So in the European Society of Cardiology 2014 says that one symptom and one diagnostic test are needed to clinically suspect myocarditis in these patients. So myocarditis is an important cause of LV dysfunction as well as this arrhythmia. So that is the way it usually presents, either LV dysfunction or the arrhythmias. So we'll talk about some myocarditis where the biopsy is very important. Two of these are the eosinophilic myocarditis. It's also known as the hypersensitivity myocarditis, where because of hypersensitivity to some drug, usually the person develops rash, fever, and eosinophilia. So this is the typical presentation. And of course, the ECG abnormalities and rapidly progressive heart failure. And this is when you would like to take a biopsy. And then if there is eosinophilic infiltrate, which is very usually the yield of the biopsy is very high, and then if you give them high dose steroids and azathioprine, they have a much better recovery than if you don't give these drugs. So this is one case where you would do an endomyocardial biopsy. The other case is the giant cell myocarditis. It also presents as fulminant or symptomatic acute myocarditis, and it is usually fatal in a few months unless you do an endomyocardial biopsy. Diagnose giant cell myocarditis, which means there are the giant cells all over the myocardium, but there's really no granuloma, and they do well with immunosuppressive therapies of steroids, cyclosporine plus or minus azathioprine. So usually these are the types of myocarditis you might get. You might get eosinophilic, you might get a giant cell, you might get lymphocytic myocarditis. So out of them, these two need to be diagnosed so that you can treat them. And that is why in fulminant myocarditis, or when the person is having a rapidly progressive LV dysfunction, or he is needing some sort of inotropic support, that is when you would need to do an endomyocardial biopsy. So when do you perform an endomyocardial biopsy and when do you do the magnetic resonance? If a person is in the fulminant stage, usually the biopsy for the reasons that I said, and the person may not be able to tolerate MRI. In acute myocarditis without complications, which means the person just has LV dysfunction, then of course a cardiac MRI has a 90% sensitivity to diagnose myocarditis. So this is a good test to do, for you to know whether the person has myocarditis or not. If the person has unstable arrhythmia, especially VT, VF, then of course you would not like to send them to the MRI, and you would directly again proceed with the endomyocardial biopsy. So if the person is having a lot of ventricular arrhythmias, then of course the endomyocardial biopsy is again needed. And the endomyocardial biopsy is also done in the dilated cardiomyopathy inflammatory type where more than 3 months. So this is another subset. So we had three subsets. One is less than 2 weeks, you call it fulminant. Then between 2 weeks to 3 months, you call it acute myocarditis. More than 3 months, you call it dilated cardiomyopathy inflammatory subset. So when these people, so more than 3 months, but they're not responding to treatment, or the person was sort of okay and then again he suddenly started deteriorating, that is when you would again do a MRI as well as a biopsy, because here you want the biopsy to see that there is inflammation, to confirm that there is inflammation that you have already seen on the MRI, and also to see that there are no viral particles. So once there are no viral particles, that is when you can start the immunosuppressive therapy. And recent trials have shown that there is definitely some improvement in ejection fraction and also in the rate at which these people go to a heart transplant. So what is this myocarditis? Pathologically, like you have the old Dallas criteria, which even with proper biopsy, the yield was only 25%. But here again, you had active myocarditis and myocarditis. Active myocarditis means apart from inflammation, there has to be necrosis. Now with the immunohistological techniques, the myocarditis means you need to have more than 14 leukocytes per millimeter square. And again, you can differentiate them into T cells or B cells. And then there is this active myocarditis where you have necrosis cells also. So quite similar to the histological, and if you have cell necrosis, you call it active. Or if there is just myocarditis, if there is just cellular infiltration, you call it myocarditis. And then, of course, you need to check if there is a DNA or RNA detection of these viral particles inside your sample. So both these things need to be done in the biopsy. Now, why do we need biopsy in some of these patients? As you can see, this was a study of 210 patients with proven myocarditis by biopsy. These people had the symptoms of heart failure along with ECG echo changes and a positive troponin, and that's why they had a biopsy. Now when they followed them up for around 2 years, they found that the initial subset itself in around 25% of these people, they had normal LV functions. And the reason why they had a biopsy was they either had a heart block or arrhythmia or palpitations, something like that, and that is why, along with positive troponins, and that's why they had the biopsy. In the rest, there was LV dysfunction. And you look at the patients who had LV dysfunction, almost half of them at the end of 2 years had significant LV dysfunction, which means they had not improved. So this is the difference between fulminant myocarditis and acute myocarditis. So the longer a person seems to have myocarditis, the worse is the recovery of his LV function, because in almost 80% to 70% of the fulminant ones, either they die at that time or they recover fully. But in this acute myocarditis and in the later parts, which means around 3 months, if you do a biopsy and they're still not recovering and defined myocarditis, almost half of them will go ahead and go into dilated cardiomyopathy. So this is the reason why people are exploring to see if any immunosuppression is possible in these people who have dilated cardiomyopathies of an inflammatory variety at around 3 months after onset of symptoms. So this is the American Heart Association chart showing how to deal with them. If there is no inflammation, there is no virus, it is post-myocarditis, dilated cardiomyopathy 10, then of course there's nothing much you can do, which means, you know, the person has long-standing dilated cardiomyopathy. In these cases, you will not do biopsy. So in a person with long-standing dilated cardiomyopathy, unless the person has ventricular tachycardias or fresh onset of worsening heart failure or heart blocks, you will not do the biopsy. So this is that subset. There's another subset where usually less than 6 months, like I said, either fulminant or acute or between 3 to 6 months, you diagnose as fulminant myocarditis, acute myocarditis, or dilated cardiomyopathy with inflammatory variant. In these cases, if you do an endomyocardial biopsy and you see giant cell or eosinophilic or sarcoid, you can treat them with good results. And sometimes you can, in case they are going into shock, if you can give them prolonged Impella support, which is called Propella. So actually, more than the ECMO, the Impella does better in these people because it actually unloads the left ventricle, unlike the ECMO, which does not unload the left ventricle that well. So if you can unload the left ventricle, it was found that actually the inflammation goes down. So there is a mechanical component also. So you have to unload and then you give the specific immunotherapy, and then these people have significantly improved mortality compared with those who do not receive this type of treatment, and many of them actually recover pretty well. And then, of course, this we have discussed, dilated cardiomyopathy, where you have some indication for biopsy, usually shorter duration or sudden onset or a very fulminant course, which means the person has a very deteriorating symptomatology, or he is developing heart blocks or arrhythmias, that is when you would like to do a biopsy. And again, if you get inflammation positive but no viral load, then again they have found that immunosuppression with corticosteroids and azathioprine improves mortality, and actually the heart blocks and the arrhythmias also might get better with the immunosuppression. And then there is another subset where the virus is also present. This is one place where you would not like to give the immunosuppressive therapy, but you would, in some cases like the herpes virus, there is specific treatment for it. The adenovirus also, there is some specific treatment. So this is a subset where you give antiviral treatment rather than immunosuppressive treatment. So the indications for endomyocardial biopsy, very important. Like I said, fulminant myocarditis, less than 2 weeks, the person has come to you with a shock, then you have to do a biopsy to rule out giant cell and eosinophilic myocarditis, and sometimes sarcoidosis also. Then unexplained new onset heart failure of 2 weeks to 3 months. This is the acute myocarditis case, especially if there is a high degree AV block or ventricular arrhythmias. So these are the cases when you would do a biopsy. And then biopsy is also done in some cases. For example, in a person having dilated cardiomyopathy with eosinophilia, like you said, you could suspect that this could be eosinophilic or endomyocardial type of cardiomyopathy, in which case you would do a biopsy. Sometimes where there are tumors, you would do a biopsy, but you cannot, if you suspect myxoma, because of the chance of embolization for the other tumors, you can do a biopsy. And in some cases of arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy or infiltrative diseases, you'll do a biopsy. So basically, this is the whole thing about the biopsy. And this is a summary of the myocarditis presentation. So fulminant myocarditis, then acute viral myocarditis. These could be asymptomatic. Symptomatic by way of heart failure or arrhythmias or heart blocks, or they can present as early dilated cardiomyopathy. Then you have dilated cardiomyopathy, inflammatory type, or very, very rarely you have a dilated cardiomyopathy where due to arrhythmias or heart blocks or rapid, he was stable but started deteriorating suddenly, and you did a biopsy, and in 10% you find a myocarditis. And then there are the cases that just present with VT. So no other problems. The first presentation itself is a VT, but the person has myocarditis. He could be having heart blocks. So in which case, like I said, we already discussed about the treatment. And it's very important to avoid exertion, NSAIDs and alcohol for the first 3 to 6 months. So this is one of those cardiac diseases where you impose severe and strict bed rest. Myocarditis is one such disease where initially you would admit them because of the arrhythmia risk, and later on you would impose severe bed rest. So once this myocarditis part is gone, like I said, you have to suspect myocarditis in certain situations. To summarize, basically in those who have a viral prodrome, or those who have fulminant myocarditis, or those who have either a rapidly degenerating heart failure, or arrhythmias, or heart block. So these are the cases where you would suspect myocarditis. So if none of them is there, then of course you would have to suspect that this could be a familial cardiomyopathy. This is present in 20 to 50%. You need a 4-generation family history, which means you need to carefully chart out on a piece of paper multiple generations and check them by ECG and echocardiograms also, and genetic testing wherever it is possible. In many cities nowadays, genetic testing is possible, and this tells us that the person has familial cardiomyopathy. So basically, the idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy is a diagnosis of exclusion. So first you have to exclude these 4 or 5 causes: ischemic, valvular, and then hypertensive heart disease, Then congenital heart disease, you have to exclude those tachycardiomyopathies, you have to exclude those five causes. Then you have to exclude medications, and then infiltrative diseases, then toxic diseases, endocrine diseases, connective tissue diseases, which usually these are evident when you do a systemic examination. So this becomes pretty evident. And then, of course, you can diagnose idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy. So we will go to some of those diseases like sarcoid, which are important to diagnose and exclude in every patient with these types of cardiomyopathies later on. So next we come to, once we are done with the dilated cardiomyopathy, so basically here you are excluding myocarditis, you are excluding the genetic component, then you are excluding certain systemic diseases, some of which overlap with the restrictive cardiomyopathy and which we will discuss, and then you come to the diagnosis of idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy, and then just you treat them for heart failure. There is no etiological diagnosis as such, etiological treatment as such in these patients. So next we come to the patients with heart failure with a preserved ejection fraction. So this is the patient with preserved ejection fraction. So you have patients with increased wall thickness, which could be hypertensive heart disease or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So basically, these two are easy diagnosis to make. So we will not deal with them. And then, of course, the infiltrative types of cardiomyopathy that have increased wall thickness. And then those that do not have the increased wall thickness are either a high output heart failure, again, which is you can diagnose by systemic examination of these patients. And then you are left with either restrictive cardiomyopathy or constrictive pericarditis. In the restrictive cardiomyopathy, you have this endomyocardial fibrosis, radiation, iron overload, and the idiopathic ones. In the ones with the LV thickness increased, you have amyloidosis and the glycogen storage disease. So this is the way you proceed. First is you look whether the person has a systolic dysfunction or not. Then if the person has heart failure with the normal ejection fraction, you would see whether the person has LV thickness or not. And if the LV thickness is increased, you would think of infiltrative cardiomyopathies like amyloidosis or glycogen storage. If it is not increased, then you would think of these diseases like endomyocardial fibrosis, radiation, iron overload, and idiopathic. And of course, you have to rule out constrictive pericarditis. So this is a very important chart to remember, because this is the way we will proceed with the etiological diagnosis. So one thing is the heart failure with the preserved ejection fraction. This we have discussed previously. It is mainly an echocardiographic diagnosis along with the syndrome complex and increased proBNPs. So it has multiple components, which you have discussed previously. Usually on the echocardiogram, you get diastolic dysfunction, atrial enlargement, hypertrophy, increased RV systolic pressures, and sometimes RV and LV dilatations also. So the diagnosis in most cases is by symptoms, and then of course the E by EA is very, very important on the echocardiogram to diagnose diastolic dysfunction. And then of course the BNP, which might be peculiarly be normal if he's already being treated, or there is no cardiac dilatation in some cases of restriction because of lack of cardiac dilatation, the BNP might actually be normal. And then in some patients, you need to exercise them to get their symptoms and to get an increase in the pulmonary wedge pressures so that you can diagnose with exercise this entity of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. So restrictive cardiomyopathy is one of those extreme diseases that could be put in those bracket. But so you get you get two problems here. One is with the immediate relaxation, which is called the lusotropy of the heart, and then later on with the delayed relaxation of the heart. So both these problems are there. Initially, it starts like this when the pressure increases, the LV and diastolic pressure behaves like this. And then, of course, there could be diseases of the pericardial restraint or even chamber dilatation, like we discussed before, can produce increased LV and diastolic pressures. So the way to diagnose these diseases, the systolic dysfunction diseases or the restrictive cardiomyopathy diseases is, of course, the most important thing is the echocardiogram. And in the echocardiogram, you have this E by A ratios, the normal, the impaired, the pseudonormal, restrictive, and non-reversible. So till here, if you do a Valsalva maneuver in the strain phase, actually, when you're maintaining, actually, this goes down by 1 to 2 grades. So this, the Valsalva is very important, because if you get a pattern like these pseudonormal or the restrictive reversible ones, then you do Valsalva, many times it go back, it goes to the impaired relaxation. So then you know that this is the pseudonormal thing. Of course, you can measure the EDT, the slope here also, but the Valsalva is also extremely important. And later on, it becomes non-reversible. Non-reversible means even with the strain phase of Valsalva, when the LV is filling less, you do not get the pseudonormal. It does not go into the pseudonormalization pattern. And then more important than the E by A is, of course, the E prime, which is the longitudinal strain at the annulus, and the E prime, E to E prime ratio, if it is more than 14, it means that the person has diastolic dysfunction. So this is very, very important. For example, if the E prime velocity is more than 8 or 9 centimeters, then restrictive cardiomyopathy is almost ruled out. So the echocardiogram is a beautiful way to very easily determine whether the person has diastolic dysfunction and what type of diastolic dysfunction also. We'll discuss later. You can also look at the pulmonary vein velocities in a simple four-chamber view itself by putting the Doppler at the pulmonary vein. So initially, there is more flow into the atrium during the systole. So this is systole and diastole. And then gradually it reverses. The systole decreases, the diastolic flow increases, and there is actually atrial reversal. So all these things can very easily be measured on the echocardiogram. That tells you that these people have diastolic dysfunction. So in this restrictive cardiomyopathy, like we have already seen, like there are these inflammatory patterns, like the endomyocardial fibrosis, the low flux cardiomyopathy, post-irradiation, the non-infiltrative ones, the hypertrophic, the familial diabetic and scleroderma, the infiltrative ones, amyloidosis, sarcoidosis, storage diseases like hemochromatosis, glycogen storage, Fabry's disease, and the idiopathic. So we need to discuss these things almost one by one. Otherwise, we cannot get to the differential etiological differential diagnosis. So first is the glycogen storage diseases. So there are four of them, the Fabry's, the Pompe's, Danon, and the PRKAG2 mutation. So all of them present in childhood or early adulthood with heart failure and left ventricular hypertrophy. So basically, they present with left ventricular hypertrophy, they press on both ECG and echo. So both it is there. On ECG and echo, you get left ventricular hypertrophy in young people who present with heart failure. And then you have to think about these glycogen storage diseases. Fabry's disease is because of a deficiency in the alpha galactosidase. These are young people. They have acroparesthesias and papules over the thighs and buttocks along with proteinuria. The ECG also shows LVH with deep T inversions and RBB. In some cases, and a short PR. And the diagnosis is made by checking the enzyme levels in the leukocytes of the blood, and you can, where you have genetic testing, once if you suspect, you can send for genetic testing also. The rest three, the Pompe, Danon, and the other ones present with the skeletal muscle pain. So CPK is very important. So basically, any person with cardiomyopathy, it might be a good idea to do a infiltrative type or where the thickness is more. It might be good to do a CPK, because if you do a CPK, it tells you that there is muscle involvement also, and then immediately you are these diagnoses strike your mind. So basically, skeletal muscle pain, mental retardation, and WPW on the ECG, and then the biopsy tells you that they have this problem. Friedreich's disease is, again, it presents like a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, like a phenotype, along with heart failure, four limb ataxia, and diabetes mellitus. So we have to remember these things, these storage diseases and the Friedreich's ataxia also, because these are important causes of diastolic heart failure in young people who present like HCM, both echocardiogram-wise and ECG-wise. The other ones are the endomyocardial diseases, endomyocardial fibrosis. I'm sure both Dr. Rajesh and Dr. Tom will have a good experience with this. This is common in those areas, quite uncommon in where I stay in Hyderabad, and I think in the north also it's quite uncommon, the endomyocardial fibrosis. So it has a bimodal distribution at around age 10 years and 30 years. The cause is not known, could be parasitic infection, something to do with the food that they eat and protein malnutrition. So there is acute active phase with eosinophilia, and then there is a phase where there is more clotting, and then there is a chronic phase where there is biventricular restriction, there is apical obliteration with clot and fibrosis, and the valves seem to get tethered, producing mitral regurgitation and tricuspid regurgitation. And also there is a disproportionate incidence of ascites with the lymphocytic cell morphology. So the treatment here is again, usually the diagnosis is quite evident on the echocardiogram itself, but if you want, you can do a biopsy. Most people would not do a biopsy because it's quite characteristic of endomyocardial fibrosis. The hypereosinophilic syndromes, low flux endocarditis, basically there is hypereosinophilia in the blood lasting for more than 1 month. So this is a very important thing. So some cases present with fulminant myocarditis, some cases present over a longer duration. So the eosinophil count is very important. It again has three phases, the necrotic part, the thrombotic part, and the fibrotic part. And this has some response to steroids and hydroxyurea. And some patients might need an endomyocardial biopsy. Endocardial fibroelastosis is, of course, a disease of infants. The same type of pathology limited to the endocardium, producing a very glistening type of endocardium with heavy regurgitation. So we'll not look into that. And then the fourth type of this disease, the sort of endomyocardial fibrotic type of disease, is the carcinoid heart disease, where there is a neuroendocrine tumor in the midgut or in the bronchi. And it leads to a triad of diarrhea, flushing, and bronchospasm, and episodic hypotension because of the increased serotonin levels that are released periodically. The diagnosis, once you suspect by echocardiogram, which again shows you these plaques and then the valve involvement and the regurgitation. So this is quite characteristic. The echocardiogram is quite characteristic. You have to do a 24 hours urinary 5-hydroxy indolacetic acid levels, and then of course you can get a diagnosis. So basically these are diagnoses that can be made quite easily provided we have them in our differential diagnosis. So we have to have these are the four types of endomyocardial fibrotic type of diseases. So we had four types of storage diseases, and then there are four types of endomyocardial fibrotic diseases, all of them present quite similarly. So once we know these basics, then we'll go to the differential diagnosis. Suspected heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, long-standing hypertension. Of course, it's we have to think that it is hypertensive heart disease. If it is not there, if the ECG looks, if the ECG has a hypertrophic pattern, then like I said before, if the ECG and the echo both have a hypertrophic pattern, then you have to think of the storage disease, the Fabry's disease. If there is four limb ataxia, you have to think of Friedreich's ataxia. If you have skeletal myopathy, you have to think of the Danon-Pompe or the PKR mutation. And if you have increased wall thickness, then you might think that it is a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy going into a with some amount of restrictive component. So if there is no LVH pattern, which means either the echo has LVH or no LVH, but the ECG does not have LVH, then you have to, if there is a there is no diastolic dysfunction, and in fact E prime is high, Sorry, my marker is gone. Yeah. So I, like I said, the E prime is very important. This tissue Doppler indicator is extremely important. If the E prime is high, then you think of constrictive pericarditis, because in the rest of the restrictive diseases, the E prime has to be decreased. If the E prime is high, more than 8, then you have to think of constrictive pericarditis. If that is not there, and there is a monoclonal gammopathy, you have to think of amyloidosis. Anti-malarial drugs, hydroxychloroquine and all, which are used many times, produce a diastolic dysfunction with some amount of thickening of the myocardium also. If that usage is there, you have to consider this disease and you have to stop the drug and monitor them for the next 3 months. If this is also not there, if there is a typical echo picture of endomyocardial fibrosis, then you have to think of those four diseases, like I said before, the endomyocardial fibrotic type of diseases. And then, of course, like Dr. Tom was mentioning, the ferritin, we check in every patient with heart failure if the serum ferritin levels are high, or if he has a substrate of multiple needing multiple transfusions, or chronic kidney diseases needing multiple iron transfusions, then you have to do MRI, which very characteristically can rule in or rule out hemosiderosis. And then, of course, even if this is not there, you have to check whether there is any history of radiation. The typical radiation cardiomyopathy has involvement of everything, which means the muscle is involved and the valves are also characteristically involved. So there's valve calcification. So if you get valve calcification, it tells you that the person could be having a radiation cardiomyopathy. Because many patients with radiation could have some other cardiomyopathies also. So you have to look at this valve calcification. If it is there, you think of a radiation cardiomyopathy. And if it is not, if all these are not there, just like in dilated, idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy, by a process of exclusion, you come to primary restrictive cardiomyopathy. So this is a pattern which you use to diagnose the etiological diagnosis of restrictive pattern of heart failure. So we'll come to some of these diseases. Cardiac sarcoidosis is an important cause of both restrictive cardiomyopathy, dilated cardiomyopathy, sometimes fulminant myocarditis, and sometimes arrhythmias leading to death. So it is a very, very important cause that every cardiologist should be aware of how to diagnose sarcoidosis and other types of granulomatous myocarditis or granulomatous cardiomyopathies. So in sarcoid, the basic thing is almost 90% of people have lung involvement. So basically, you have to look at lung symptoms, and many of these people come with lung symptoms. And then, of course, these are the percentages of other things that are involved: the skin, lymph nodes, eye, liver, erythema nodosum, spleen, neurological parotid, bone, calcium, ENT, cardiac, and even the kidneys involved, because they secrete out more calcium. The urine has more calcium, so the kidneys are also involved. So on the X-ray, many times the X-ray itself, even in the sort of asymptomatic person with some sort of restriction or dilated, if you see this sort of bilateral hilar adenopathy, which this is stage A, B, C, like that, as you know, this sort of increases, and later on you get this fluffy shadows of interstitial fibrosis, and later on you get the fibrotic elements also, just like in tuberculosis. And on the CT, you get this distribution of this fine nodule-like things across the bronchovascular tree, or where are the bronchovascular markings. You get this type of nodular opacities on the CT. So basically, sarcoidosis is it is non-caseating granulomatous disease of unknown cause, that usually starts affecting the mid part of the basal septum. So this is the usual area where it starts affecting people. In fact, the first case that I saw was a wife of one of my colleagues who had a heart block. And on echo, I remember actually this part of the septum was very thinned out and this part was bulged out. And I was that time wondering what it could be. And later on it turned out to be sarcoidosis. But by that time, we had already put in a pacemaker. So if we had known that it was sarcoid, we would have put a ICD and not a pacemaker. Because in sarcoidosis, the indication for pacemaker automatically becomes an indication for an ICD. But anyway, so the first involvement is that area, and then the basal areas, the other basal areas, the lateral walls, and then the RV wall also starts getting affected. So they might present as heart failure, or they might present as heart blocks, or they might present with reentrant ventricular tachycardia, fibrillation, and sudden cardiac death. So the diagnostic modalities in sarcoidosis, the ECG is abnormal in only 5% of asymptomatic patients, which means you need to use the cardiac MR, the CMR for a diagnosis of cardiac sarcoidosis in case there is extra pulmonary sarcoidosis, or like we said, they have the symptoms of the heart blocks or the VT or unexplained heart failure. Then of course you need to use the cardiac magnetic resonance to look for sarcoid. So, but by the time the person has some symptoms, usually the ECG shows changes, fragmentation in 75%, RBB in 75%, 25%, LBB in only 5%. So basically it shows some sort of IVCD, some sort of conduction defect and fragmentation, and sometimes heart blocks, which are more specific for sarcoid than for any other cardiomyopathy. So if a person less than 60 years comes with heart blocks, then you have to rule out sarcoid and of course VT. So these are the ways it presents. The echo, like I said, will show regional wall motion abnormality, thinning, sometimes basal septal thickening, diastolic dysfunction, the ejection fraction could be reduced, RV dysfunction could be there without pulmonary hypertension. So this is also a type of presentation which I saw in one person recently. Person had RV dysfunction on MRI without any pulmonary hypertension. He had actually presented with syncope. And later on, it turned out to be sarcoidosis. And then the endomyocardial biopsy, it is rarely used nowadays, but the yield is only 25%. But you can increase the yield whenever you are doing an EP study. Suppose you are doing an EP study in a patient who has non-specific symptoms of giddiness, and you know that there is some sarcoid, you want to do EP study. At that time, wherever there are fractionated signals, or wherever the border of the scar, if you can take a biopsy, then the yield is much more. So that is one time when you can use both of them. The cardiac magnetic resonance is very important. T2 shows the edema. The late gadolinium enhancement will show the fibrosis in the basal, septal, and the lateral walls, in the mid-myocardium and in the epicardium. Unlike in coronary artery disease, where it's mainly the scar is mainly proceeds from the endocardium to the epicardium, here it is mid-myocardium and it is a scattered pattern, not in the coronary distribution, you get this fibrosis. The sensitivity and the specificity vary between 75% to specificity, almost 90% to 100%. The late gadolinium enhancement is very important to estimate the chance of the person having a VT or sudden cardiac death if there's a lot of fibrosis. Especially mid-myocardial fibrosis, then the hazard ratio might be as high as 35 times. And the PET, the fluorodeoxyglucose one, will show inflammation. So you can use at the same time as you're doing the PET, you can use perfusion markers also to show that there's a scar. So basically, just like a CMR, you can use the PET to show both active inflammation as well as scar. And it can be used to gauge the response to treatment also. So the PET is a very important diagnostic and treatment and a modality to follow treatment in sarcoidosis. It has similar sensitivity and specificity to cardiac MRI. So many times both are used, as you can see. Here the late gadolinium enhancement shows a typical pattern of epicardial and midmyocardial patchy scarring. And around those areas of scar, you get active inflammation through the FDG PET. So basically, you are seeing both inflammation as well as scarring, which tells you that, and this sort of patchy thing tells you that this is most likely sarcoidosis in a non-acute setting. So in case there's a fulminant myocarditis, you cannot diagnose this. But in a non-acute setting, the sarcoid is the most common cause for this type of presentation. So there are two pathways to diagnosis. One is the histological diagnosis was made from the myocardial tissue itself, which is not the common way. The other one is the histological diagnosis was made from extra cardiac sarcoidosis. Usually, you send it to the pulmonologist and he uses the EBUS or something else to get a lymph node sample. So that is the way the extra cardiac sarcoidosis diagnosis is made. And then you have these things that point to the diagnosis of cardiac involvement. Either he has unexplained LV dysfunction with sarcoid, with the proven sarcoid elsewhere, then you will think that he has cardiac sarcoidosis. Or he had a steroid-responsive cardiomyopathy or heart block. The person had heart block, he gave them steroid, and in 3 weeks, in 2 weeks, the heart block went away. Then you would think that it could be sarcoidosis, or he had unexplained VT or heart block or patchy uptake on FDG PET or cardiac MRI. So these are the cases in which you would suspect that the person has cardiac involvement when there is already systemic sarcoidosis and it has been diagnosed. Or you have a patient who comes with cardiac involvement and you search for the extra cardiac sources where you can get a tissue biopsy, usually the lung lymph nodes. And then from that, you get the extra cardiac diagnosis of extra cardiac sarcoidosis and most probably cardiac sarcoidosis. And you have to, of course, rule out the other causes that could produce things like that. So in 30%, you might get, so where there is extra cardiac sarcoidosis, the diagnosis is pretty easy. But if you have only isolated cardiac sarcoidosis, which happens in 30%, then it becomes a very difficult case. So when do you suspect? So if the person should have both clinical symptoms, like I said, are usually heart failure or heart blocks or VT, which could be just palpitations or syncope. And you have to have a suspicious ECG, echo or Holter. So with these basic things only, as you can see in one study, they found a sensitivity and specificity, very high sensitivity and specificity, which means if these are not there, if the person does not have symptoms and his ECG echo Holter are normal, then you don't need to suspect cardiac sarcoidosis in every patient with some other findings. So basically, the person should have mainly these things, unexplained VT, heart blocks, and ECG echo showing either fragmentation of the ECG or echo showing regional wall motion abnormality in the non-cardiac territory, then you suspect cardiac sarcoidosis. Then you can use both the CMR and the FDG PET, like we showed in those pictures, to make a probable diagnosis of sarcoid. And this, some people say that you have to have a biopsy, some people say that it's not needed. So that is inconclusive, but you can start treatment with this once you have a positive CMR and an FDG PET. So where do you start immunosuppressants? Because the one reason why you want etiological diagnosis is you want to treat them with immunosuppressants. So heart blocks, VT, and LV dysfunction, but you need signs of inflammation. So the signs of inflammation means either you have them on the biopsy, or if you don't want to do a biopsy, the PET is a very important and easy way to diagnose inflammation. So if the PET scan shows inflammation and they have these things, either LV dysfunction, heart blocks, or arrhythmias, then you can treat them with immunosuppressives. So this is the way you treat them. You start with around 30 milligrams of prednisolone, repeat PET scan after 3 months. If the PET scan shows decreased inflammation, you decrease it gradually to 10 milligrams of prednisolone, and then you treat them for a year and you stop. And if there is a recurrence, of course, then you have to repeat the process again. If it's not responding, you add methotrexate. So this is the way you treat them. But the whole thing is you should suspect sarcoidosis in these patients. And the ICD, when is the AICD needed? If the person has VT or he has a LV ejection fraction less than 35%. So this is just like any other indication, either a VT or this thing. The thing that I was talking about is an indication for a permanent pacemaker when the person has a high degree AV block. So if you give them steroids and the high degree AV block vanishes, then also you need to put a pacemaker, and usually it's better to put an ICD in these people rather than a pacemaker. In those persons who have moderate LV dysfunction or where the symptoms are not classic, a person just has giddiness and all, you can use the EP study to tell you whether you need to put an ICD or not. And then, of course, you can use the imaging also to help you in determining whether the person needs these treatments or not. So basically, very simple thing is the person should have inflammation for you to start immunosuppression. And for the ICD, the person needs either a VT on the EP or clinical VT or syncope, or he has an indication for pacing, which is even a temporary heart block. So this is the other thing, that advanced cardiac imaging is not needed in asymptomatic people who have normal ECG center, because this is what I had discussed previously. So if the person has a sarcoidosis, extra cardiac sarcoidosis, but his ECG echo are normal and he does not have palpitations, syncope, then you don't need to do any further testing. So once we are done with the sarcoid, some people would test for tuberculosis also in the same way that they do for sarcoid, with some, of course, skin tests and blood and tissue tests for tuberculosis. It is slightly controversial, but if they make a diagnosis or they suspect tuberculosis, some of them would give them a 9 months or a 1 year course of anti-tubercular drugs in patients with granulomatous cardiomyopathy, just like sarcoid. So once we know sarcoid, if we want to treat suspecting tuberculosis, then we can treat, but there's really not much evidence that it helps much, but a lot of people do treat. Then comes radiation-induced heart disease. So there is a history of radiation of more than 20 gray. And the latent, this is the most peculiar thing, the latent period could be usually is around 10 to 15 years. It means 10 to 15 years after the radiation, the person starts manifesting heart failure symptoms. And in between, if you do a strain rate imaging or you do a cardiac MRI, many times you can see that the person already has problems with his heart. So, but for them to develop symptoms, it takes so long. And of course, the anthracyclines make it worse. This is a disease that affects the coronary arteries, which means the person could have coronary artery disease because of radiation, could produce restrictive cardiomyopathies, could produce constrictive pericarditis, and could produce valvular heart disease. One of our pediatrician's brother had radiation for Hodgkin's, I think, more than 20 years ago. And now he has all these things. He had stents put in 2 times. He has no other coronary artery disease risk factors. He has severe diastolic dysfunction with heart failure. He cannot tolerate much diuretics also. And he has a valvular regurgitation and valvular calcium also. So valvular calcium on echocardiogram is a very important way to say that the person has radiation-induced heart disease. So this is an important chart, which actually the only thing it does is it in these people with restrictive cardiomyopathy, less than 30 years, I've already said that those genetic diseases and the glycogen storage diseases, they all manifest as some sort of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy-like picture with restrictive symptoms. In early childhood, in late childhood, or early adulthood. So that is when they manifest, including some forms of hematochromatosis also manifest early. And those that are more than 65 years, you have to rule out hypertensive heart disease, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, constrictive pericarditis, high output heart failure. And then you come to these specific diseases. We have already covered sarcoidosis, and we'll cover amyloidosis and hemochromatosis also. And we already covered the radiation and the storage diseases. So the one bifurcation, one way to do it is to bifurcate those people with early restrictive cardiomyopathy and those who present later. Because as age increases, there is a bigger chance that the person could be having just hypertensive heart disease or amyloidosis. So these are the two diseases that increase markedly with age. So we'll come to amyloidosis, which is a very important diagnosis, which we often miss. The echo shows, by atrial enlargement, shows the thickened myocardium. It has a very speckled appearance. The valves could, the leaflets could be thickened, the interatrial septum could be thickened, and it shows this typical diastolic dysfunction. The E by A is 2:1 or more. The EDT is less, and if you do a Valsalva manual, some of them might go into pseudo-normalization pattern. That is the way you diagnose here. And the most important thing is, of course, the E prime, which is less in all cases of diastolic dysfunction with restrictive components. So this is very important. If the E prime is more than 9 or 10, you have to think of constrictive pericarditis. And then, of course, you get this very typical diastolic reversal of hepatic flow during inspiration. So what happens during inspiration? There is more blood coming into the atria, and so there is a diastolic reversal. So this is in contrast to the expiratory diastolic reversal that you get in constrictive pericarditis. In constrictive pericarditis, what happens is during expiration, more blood is pushed into the left ventricle, and the septum, because of ventricular interdependence, the septum moves into the right, limiting the right ventricular filling, and therefore you get the diastolic reversal in expiration. So basically, that's a big difference between restrictive cardiomyopathy and constrictive pericarditis. In restrictive cardiomyopathy, you get these nice reversals during inspiration. In constrictive pericarditis, you get it in expiration, because in expiration the LV is filled up and the RV is made small. So there are two types of amyloidosis. One is the light chain amyloidosis, which is called AL, which is basically a plasma dyscrasia, plasma cell abnormality, a type of malignancy or premalignant disease, which produces a lot of light chains. And these fold into insoluble amyloid fibrils. So basically, amyloid is something that is not a very soluble or degradable product. So it is like plastic in our environment. So wherever it is, it gets, stuck. And then amyloid actually has a very bad effect on the myocardium itself. So even very little amyloid can produce severe restrictive component, although the amyloid itself, the deposition of amyloid itself between the cells is less. So this is the AL type, and then you have the AT type, which means the transthyretin. So basically, either it is the light chains or this transthyretin, which is a which is produced by the liver, which is used for transporting thyroxines and retinol. And this, for some reason, either with increasing age or because of mutations, which is the hereditary type of amyloidosis, you get this sort of folding, which again produces this insoluble amyloid. So basically, two types of amyloid: either light chain, which is a plasma cell dyscrasia, or transthyretin, which is with increasing age or with a familial type of mutation, it produces amyloid. So basically, this molecule, thyretin is produced by the liver. And if you put a Congo red stain, you get this typical apple green birefringence in a polarized light microscopy. So before the electron microscope came, this was the way it was diagnosed. You put a Congo red stain and look under a polarizing microscope, and you get this characteristic apple green birefringence. So in cardiac amyloidosis, the amyloid gets deposited so that there is thickening and loss of diastolic dysfunction, later systolic dysfunction also, and it gets deposited in the ventricle, interatrial septum, and in the leaflets also. So the, like I said, the trans thyretin thing can be because of a genetic mutation also, especially in some populations like the African Americans, it is quite common. And it could either produce neurological problems or cardiac problems depending upon the mutation. So how do you diagnose the amyloidosis? So basically, the amyloid presents at an average age of around 50. Both the light chain one and the genetic type of transthyretin type of amyloid. Of course, the wild type is the one that presents at later age, usually at age 80 years. And there's a male preponderance and markedly male preponderance in the old age. And in the amyloid and in the light chain type of variety, you suspect when there is more atrial arrhythmias, huge atrial enlargement along the typical echo findings. There could be embolic CVA because the atria are not functioning well. And there is hepatomegaly because of the deposition in the liver and proteinuria also. And many of them have autonomic dysfunction, carpal tunnel syndromes, and a very typical finding of macroglossia and periorbital purpura in around 10%. So this is not common, but if you get this thick tongue and along with some amount of proteinuria and autonomic dysfunction along with the typical echo findings, then you're quite sure it is amyloid of a light type, of the light chain type. And in the mutant variety, usually in the middle age, again, it mainly presents with gastrointestinal symptoms, diarrhea, weight loss, along with autonomic dysfunction. Many of these people are actually diagnosed to have chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy. I think it's called CIPD. So they are diagnosed with that disease, but it is actually amyloidosis. So basically, any neural involvement along with the cardiac involvement, you have to suspect amyloidosis. And in the wild type, which is a problem with old age, where the transthyretin molecule gets converted into insoluble amyloid, it is responsible for almost 20% of aortic stenosis, where it presents as aortic stenosis with a low gradient. So this is a very important subset to diagnose. And it is the cause of almost 15 to 20% of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction and LVH in this subset of people. So with increasing age, amyloid is something that you should not miss. And here again, almost half of them have bilateral carpal tunnel syndrome. So bilateral carpal tunnel syndrome is very characteristic of old age, a wild type of amyloidosis. So how do you diagnose? So basically, these are the red flags for amyloidosis. Echocardiography shows thickening. Like I'll show you this. So basically, the ECG shows, low voltage despite the thickening on the echo. Low voltage means less than 5 millimeters in the limb leads and less than 10 millimeters in the precordial leads. And then the echo shows this characteristic thickening and the speckled appearance. And there might be some amount of pericardial fluid also. So once you get these two things, and then you get these red flags, like these people have low normal blood pressures, carpal tunnel syndrome, and like already I discussed in the light chain variety, the macroglossia, the nephrotic syndrome, and the peripheral neuropathy. And in the transthyretin variety, you might get a new diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in an elderly patient. That's when you will think of this diagnosis, which means that around 50 or 60, you get a diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And if you can get a previous echo, which does not show this, then this is quite characteristic of amyloid. And also this low gradient aortic stenosis when you should suspect amyloidosis. So once you have these suspicions, which means some sort of extra cardiac problems, new onset hypertrophy or aortic stenosis, then and the typical low voltage, which is present in only 50%, so not the everybody has this, and then the thickening of the LV, which is present in almost 80%. Then this is the way you diagnose. So you have to do a serum-free light chain ratio. So if the serum-free light chain, if it is increased, the kappa and the lambda, if they are increased, and there is a monoclonal spike on immunofixation, then you know that there is a gammopathy, which means there is a plasma cell dyscrasia producing the light chains. And you, if you do a pyrophosphate scan, which is a very important for diagnosing amyloid, then you do not get increased uptake. Whereas here, you get a technetium pyrophosphate scan, it shows increased uptake. It does not show any of this monoclonal gammopathy, like picture on the blood or in the urine proteins. And then you get increased uptake on the technetium pyrophosphate scan. Then you can make a diagnosis of ATTR. So you don't need a biopsy. So this has been a big game changer, a paradigm shift, that it does not need a biopsy. The technetium pyrophosphate scan is positive, and you have excluded the gammopathies, then the only thing left is you have to distinguish between the mutant form and the genetic form by doing a genetic testing. And if you can take a biopsy, which is usually a fat pad aspirate that is taken in the light chain variety, then the biopsy can be, you can use laser microdissection and then mass spectroscopy to actually identify the exact protein that is producing the amyloidosis. That is sometimes very important because the treatment depends on the protein that is being deposited there. So this is the technetium pyrophosphate scan, which is very important in amyloidosis. So the before, so these are the ways you diagnose: the ECG, the echo. And the echo, if you can do a strain rate imaging, it shows a very characteristic thing. You get a typical bullseye pattern where the longitudinal strain rate imaging is decreased at the basal area, but it is normal at the apex. So this is a very characteristic finding of amyloidosis, which is very easy with nowadays with echocardiographic machine, because they almost automatically give this. And then, of course, the cardiac MRI will show the late gadolinium enhancement and the T2 imaging also. So this is the way you diagnose the amyloids. First, you suspect the amyloidosis by ECG, echo, and the other characteristic non-cardiac findings in these patients. And then you do a serum and urine protein electrophoresis to see a monocomponent spike in that protein. You also do a serum-free light chain assay directly to look for the kappa or the lambda chains. If you get a monoclonal type of pattern, then of course you should suspect a plasma dyscrasia, and then you do a bone marrow biopsy with or without a fat pad aspirate, and then you go ahead and diagnose amyloidosis. If this type of presentation is not there, which means there is no monoclonal protein, the light chain assay is negative for increased production of alpha, lambda, then you do a pyrophosphate scan. And if the pyrophosphate scan shows increased uptake, then you know that he has a TTR type of amyloidosis, transthyretin type of amyloidosis. And then you do a genetic testing to see if there is a genetic pattern. If there is no genetic pattern available, then you know that it's a wild type that is associated with old age. So the fat pad aspirate also is very important. You get the diagnosis in 70%, and especially in the non-TTR type of amyloidosis. And then you check it with the regular staining under a polarizing microscope to see the apical refringence type of thing, or you do a laser microdissection and do the mass spectroscopy to identify the exact protein. So that is about amyloidosis. So basically, to summarize amyloidosis, multiple papers have discussed the importance of not missing amyloidosis. Because especially you have these new drugs like tafamidis, which can improve the prognosis in the TTR variants quite well. And if you can treat the plasma dysplasia early, then you can improve the prognosis quite drastically in the light chain type of amyloidosis. Coming to the iron overload cardiomyopathy, which is another very important restrictive pattern which you have to exclude in almost every patient by doing, of course, the serum ferritin levels are done in every patient with heart failure. So there are two types, the primary hereditary hemachromatosis, where there is a problem with the absorption of iron. Iron is increasingly absorbed. Or you have the secondary types where you have to be careful in screening for iron overload, thalassemia, sickle cell anemia, myelodysplastic syndrome, a CKD with multiple iron infusions, sideroblastic anemias, where you give multiple transfusions. So once you have more than 10 or 20 transfusions, you should start screening these people. And that has made a big change, because if you can screen these people and start chelating them early, then you can prevent this disease altogether. So the diagnosis is by transferrin saturation of more than 50%, serum ferritin more than 200, more than 300 in males, more than 200 in females. And then you get this very typical T2 decay is very fast because of the iron in the tissue. The T2 decay is very fast. So if it is less than 20 seconds, it means that there is iron overload. Less than 10 means it is very severe iron overload. So this cardiac CMR type of picture has revolutionized the diagnosis of iron overload cardiomyopathy, and we can use it to screen people with more than 10 to 20 transfusions to prevent iron overload cardiomyopathy by prophylactically starting them on iron chelating treatment. So the treatment is either phlebotomy for the hemachromatosis type of patterns, or where there is anemia or multiple transfusions, you can chelate them. And you can also have a tissue diagnosis. So this is one area where a biopsy is done in some cases, where you get this typical blue-looking thing, the iron deposits. So the last one is, of course, constrictive pericarditis, which is very important in India to diagnose. Tuberculosis is, of course, the most important cause, but you can get it in radiation and post-viral myocarditis. It's also, you get these patients with markedly raised JVPs and right heart failures. And if the person has some amount of effusion, then the diagnosis becomes pretty easy, especially if there are signs of inflammation, because you might get some amount of effusions even in diseases like amyloidosis, but there, of course, the myocardium is involved on the echo. So here, if you get a effusion, then it goes more in favor of if it's a constrictive type of pathology. But this is the JVP, a large X descent and a small Y descent in the effusor constrictive, and as the effusion vanishes, you get large X descent, which is the systolic filling, and the large Y descent, which is the square root sign for the LV, which means rapid filling, and then there is equalization of pressures. So you also get a positive Kussmaul sign in constrictive pericarditis. You usually do not get it in restrictive cardiomyopathy. So this is something quite typical, which means when the patient breathes in, normally the JVP should come down a bit, although the descents are exaggerated. But in constrictive pericarditis, the JVP is increased because the atria and the ventricle fill because of the inspiration. And the two characteristic things are ventricular interdependence and loss of transmission of the intrathoracic pressure to the heart. The ventricular interdependence is very nicely seen on the echocardiogram. On inspiration, what happens is more blood comes into the RV, more blood is pooled in the lungs, and the septum moves towards the LV. In expiration, because the gradient increases, the blood is pushed into the left ventricle, and this again reduces the volume in the right ventricle. So during expiration, the E velocities on the left side increase by 25%, and during inspirations, the E velocities on the right side might increase up to 40%. So when you get these changes in the velocities of filling, then you know that there is ventricular interdependence. So the way to diagnose is of course the JVP paradoxical pulse. You can get in around 1/3 of these patients, just like in pulses in the tamponade, you might get it. The most important thing is of course the palpation. If you can palpate apex, most probably it's not constriction. So this is very important in constrictive pericarditis. You are not able to palpate any apex in the majority of the cases. And then of course you have this filling patterns where there is a pressure difference between the LV and the RV in restrictive cardiomyopathy. So in restrictive cardiomyopathy, the LV endastolic pressures are 5 millimeters or more than the RV endastolic pressure, because it's mainly LV disease, and as you know, the LV compliance as such is less than the right side normally also. So this is what happens in restrictive, but in constriction, both have to be exactly the same because they are encased in a rigid container and the septum moves from right to left and left to right to equalize the pressures. So this is the important thing. And because of this increased LV pressures, you also get more pulmonary hypertension in restrictive cardiomyopathy and less pulmonary hypertension in constrictive pericarditis. The square root sign is very characteristic of constriction. It can also happen in the restrictive one. The respiratory variation is, of course, like I said, this is an echo finding. And the septal bounce is also very important. Tissue Doppler E prime, like I already mentioned, if the E prime is increased, it effectively rules out restrictive cardiomyopathy, and the pericardial thickness by cardiac MRI is better than with the CT also. So if it's more than 4 millimeter thickness, then you suspect constriction. So these are the ways you differentiate constriction from restriction. As you can see, ventricular shift, which means the ventricular bounce that happens with inspiration and expiration, high sensitivity and specificity, the mitral E prime. No, this is the mitral change in the mitral E velocity. Like I said, more than 14, usually 25%. With expiration, the left-sided velocity is increased. With inspiration, the right-sided velocity is increased. And then the E prime velocity more than 9 cm/s will rule out the restriction. It will go in favor of a constriction. And the medial to lateral, because the lateral is reduced because of the constriction, normally the lateral is more. So when this is reduced, it goes in favor of constriction. And like I said, the hepatic vein diastolic reversal happens in expiration, because in expiration, the RV size is reduced because the LV size is increased. And that's why you get these diastolic reversals of flow in expiration. So all these things put together, if you look at them, they have very high sensitivity and specificity just by echocardiogram itself. So basically, the diagnosis nowadays is pretty easy. You do a CMR to look at the thickness of the pericardium, and it also shows that the pericardium and the myocardium are not slipping over each other. This is the loss of slippage sign, which means they are stuck with each other. The CMR shows both of these, and then you have the echocardiographic findings, which show you the physiology, that there is ventricular interdependence and there is loss of transmission of intrathoracic pressure to the heart. So both these things put together, you have a diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis. So this is the same echo findings which are shown here. In constriction, as you know, with inspiration and expiration, there's a lot of change in the filling velocities. With restriction, actually, you get a restrictive pattern. Restriction, it happens with inspiration. So this is an exaggeration of the normal phenomena, and this happens because in expiration, the RV size is reduced in constriction. So this is the same thing, like first you do an echocardiogram and then you do MRI, and usually you get a diagnosis pretty easily. So no longer is really a catheterization ever needed to make this distinguishing point. So yes, these echocardiographic findings are sort of new. See, these are not there when we were doing our DMs. And in fact, the tissue Doppler is the major change for all diastolic dysfunction heart failures. So this is the constrictive pericarditis is the only diastolic dysfunction disease that produces an increase in the E prime on the tissue Doppler. Thank you. So I think we have discussed most of them. To just summarize, we have discussed dilated cardiomyopathy, and basically we have said that it is a diagnosis of multiple exclusions. So basically you have to exclude the myocarditis and the other diseases before you come at the diagnosis of dilated cardiomyopathy. So this is the one. After excluding the major ones like hypertension, valve disease, tachycardiomyopathies, and congenital heart diseases, and then you after excluding myocarditis and the other infiltrative and other diseases that we have discussed, you come to the diagnosis of idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy, and you have to do genetic testing in all of them because some of them have treatments nowadays. And coming to the restrictive ones, once you have diagnosed restrictive LV dysfunction, then you look at two things, whether there is LVH on ECG and whether there is LVH on echo. So if there is LVH on echo, he goes into these patterns, either amyloidosis or the storage diseases. If there is no LVH on echo, it goes into the endomyocardial fibrosis, radiation, iron, or idiopathic restrictive cardiomyopathy. And then you look for the ECG, LVH on ECG. See, even after there is LVH on echo, some people will not have LVH on the ECG. Then you go into these things like the amyloidosis, the iron overload, the endomyocardial fibrosis, and things like that. If there is LVH on both the ECG and the echo, then you go into these storage diseases and the Friedreich's ataxia. So this is the whole thing about diagnosing both the dilated as well as restrictive cardiomyopathies. Thank you, and we'll take some questions. I think it was quite exhaustive, so we'll take some questions. Or Dr. Tom or Dr. Rajesh can discuss whatever they want.
Oh yes, like you yourself described, it was really wonderful and exhaustive session on heart failure etiology. But the last three flowcharts which you demonstrated are perfect, and they would be very useful. All the DMDNB students are requested to read about myocarditis and restrictive cardiomyopathy over the next couple of days. And if by following the charts, if you can work and come to a diagnosis of any of these restrictive cardiomyopathies or myocarditis, then you can consider yourself that you have crossed the final frontier of etiological diagnosis of heart failure. There are no questions today in the chat session. I think people got either they understood everything or they are really overexhausted with the brainstorming they have had. Any comments, Professor Rajesh?
So that was a very exhaustive coverage of etiological diagnosis of heart failure. I just want to add that it's very important to have a good clinical exam of a patient with idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy. I remember a young boy who came with heart failure. He was admitted to the ICU and subsequently stabilized. And then on a cursory clinical exam, we found that he had increased pigmentation in his legs, and then we made a diagnosis of primary hemochromatosis. That's a reversible cause, and the patient is doing very well with for the last 10 years without heart failure. Similarly, tachycardia cardiomyopathy is a condition which can be treatable completely, and heart failure can be reversed. Similarly, young people who come with, you would rule out glycogen storage disease like Pompe's, and Anderson Fabry disease is a disease which can be easily diagnosed with a CMR. It was T1 mapping sequence in CMR that will be, we get very low values of T1 in Anderson Fabry disease. That's a diagnostic clincher. as far as this disease condition is concerned. Similarly, sarcoid, one question. When a patient presents a complete heart block and you don't have much of cardiac involvement, or much is a question which I want to ask Dr. Ramchandra. A simple pacemaker, would that be enough?
Unless,
and then
basically, unless the person has extra cardiac sarcoid and you have a histological diagnosis of sarcoid somewhere else, to just diagnose only cardiac, isolated cardiac sarcoidosis with a heart block and negative CMR and PET is not the way, which means you cannot diagnose. Because these are quite sensitive and specific for sarcoid. So they can almost rule it out. So you don't need to do a biopsy in these patients who do not have any other, which means we'll be biopsying any patient who is less than 60 years and who has come with a heart block. So basically you have to use these new modalities. And Dr. Rajesh, now that you have that wonderful machine that does both CMR and PET at the same time.
Yeah.
I hope you and your students also learn it. For me, it's a great luxury. So for me, when I'm talking about T1 and T2, I'm really not talking from any self-experience, you know. So it would be a person who has not done echo talking about echo. So hopefully, like in future, all of us should get acquainted with cardiac magnetic resonance and the PET, because without that, I think you cannot diagnose many cardiac.
I think absolutely. CMR is a very important role in etiological diagnosis of heart failure these days. And I think CMR should be a part of an exam for any patient who presents with heart failure disease. And also, the last chart which you showed, the differentiating constriction from a restrictive physiology, is a very important chart, I think. And in patients whom we suspect constrictive pericarditis, we always do a CT to rule out LV calcification, which is a hallmark of constrictive pericarditis.
It's better than a CT, both sensitivity and specificity wise.
Yeah. And then EMF is a diagnosis which is quite common here, and I think Tom also would be seeing a lot of patients with EMF. Important etiology of restrictive cardiomyopathy. With that, I think there is a superb lecture on etiological diagnosis of heart failure. And we'll,
just to conclude, I think amyloidosis in the old age is also very important. So that is something we all keep missing, and that is the diagnosis which we can make if we just keep it in our mind. And so next time, I think Dr. Rajesh will present hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, because this is one thing that we did not touch. And at the same time, maybe we will touch some other things that we have not discussed this time, like some borderline cases like nutritional cardiomyopathies, alcoholic cardiomyopathies, which we have not touched. Because a lot of people do take some alcohol, but they have cardiomyopathy, and we do not know if they have alcoholic cardiomyopathy or some other cardiomyopathy. So there are ways to distinguish it.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you all, and good night.
Good night, good night. Bye, Tom. Bye, Ra.